In this video, we will take a look at the addition of secondary sketched features. Specifically, we'll be looking at the extrude tool, but you can also use tools like revolve and sweep and loft to create secondary features as well. Here you can see I already have an extrusion and I want to create another sketch to make another feature. To do so, just like when we started the original sketch to create a shape, I'll choose my sketch tool or type S at the keyboard. And then I will click on a plane. Now on the first extrusion, our sketch was on one of our origin planes. So I can still use the origin planes if I want. A lot of cases that's recommended because then you're not creating relationships between different planes. But in other cases, it makes more sense to sketch on a surface. So for example, I want to sketch on the surface of this part right here. So I'll go ahead and click on it. And as you can see, I'm now sketching on that plane and I'm looking directly at that surface. So now I can go ahead and add in any sketch features. I'll just go ahead and snap to this point for now and just create a circular shape. Obviously, I want to fully constrain that, but in the interest of time, I'm just going to go ahead and finish and then extrude the shape. So I'll choose my extrude tool. And as you can see, it's trying to extrude out away from the part. I want it to go into the part. So I can use my direction arrow to flip it the other way. One of the things Inventor will do is it'll recognize that I'm taking this shape and I'm putting it into a part that already exists. So it switches to the subtract mode, thinking I want to subtract material. These are controlled in the output section here with the different Boolean operations. You can see that cut was selected by default here. I can switch this back to join so that I can add material. I can also switch it to intersect to keep only the intersection of the original extrusion and this new one. If I want to add material, I'll just stick to join. If I choose new solid, it'll create the solid shape, but then over here in my browser, it'll actually create a separate solid body. For now, we want to stay away from that option, so I'll go ahead and go back to the join option here. In this particular case, the shape is being extruded a length of 2 inches. I can adjust this value, of course, if I don't want it to go the full depth, or I can put in a larger value if it needs to extend past the original part here. I can also tell it to go through all or to a selected face. So if we look at through all, this will be more if I'm doing a cut. I can do through all and it doesn't really matter what length it is. It's going to cut through all of the materials. It's also important to note it's going to cut through any other features in the background here if I do through all. We can also go to a selected surface. So I can click on a face and have it go just to that particular surface. You can see when I click OK now, it only cut out of this front portion because it stopped at this face here. When creating secondary features, the project geometry tool gets to be a little more important than it was when we just created one extrusion. I'm going to edit this sketch here and just delete this circle that I started with. And let's say that I wanted to create a circular shape centered about this back rectangular face. So I actually want to be able to use the edges here. There's a couple of different ways to do this. One is to go ahead and project the geometry. So I'll choose project geometry. I'll click on the rectangular surface back here. And you can see that that geometry has now been extended to meet the sketch plane. It's important to note that that is related to the original shape. So if for some reason the original one was modified, let's say I changed my extrusion depth to 3 inches instead of 2, you can see that the projected geometry updates. So I'll go ahead and edit this sketch again, and now that I've got that geometry there, now I can snap to it or I can constrain to it in any way. Then once more, I can come in and add dimensions there. The other thing that I can do is I can actually just go ahead and sketch and then dimension it. So I'll start a new sketch here. I'm going to sketch on this front surface. I'll go ahead and create a circle just out here in space somewhere. Typically, most people when they're sketching will look directly at the sketch. So I'll go ahead and add a dimension here from the center point to the top edge of the part here. And I'll just accept the value for now, but if we look at it, you can see that it actually automatically projected the geometry for me. So if I wanted to dimension it this direction as well, you can see that once again it will automatically project that geometry, then I can adjust my values. Next, we'll take a look at an option called minimum solution. I'm going to sketch on this front surface, then I'm going to project its geometry, and I'm going to create a rectangular extrusion here. As always, realistically, I would want to fully constrain that, but I'm just going to do a quick example here. I'm going to extrude this shape, and we talked about the different options on the previous part. I'm going to flip it so that it goes into the part. You can see right now it looks like it's going into the other part, but it's actually creating a little bit of an extrusion inside here. So I don't want to go a depth this time. I just want it to go to either to the next surface or to a specific surface. So I'm going to choose the specific surface here, the outside of the cylinder. Now this is actually doing exactly what I want, which is it's stopping at this front face here. There's an option in the little dialog box here called minimum solution. If I turn that off, it's going to give me the maximum solution, meaning it's going to go to the other side of the cylinder. I think that one is important to note because in older versions of Autodesk Inventor, I can't remember exactly when they changed this, but in older versions, the minimum solution was turned off by default, so you ended up with this shape. And you had to turn minimum solution on. So something to watch out for there. Next, we'll take a closer look at the two options with the extrude command. I'm going to sketch on the top flange of this shape here, and I'm just going to create a circular shape. I want to extrude this circular shape into the part, so I'll choose the extrude tool. As you can see, it's going the wrong way, so I'm going to flip it. As you can see, going a distance isn't the right choice here because it's going to bring it to the outside. So I want to go to the surface inside here. If I choose the two option and select a face, it's not going to work because this circular shape does not fully terminate on this one surface. So this is an example where the two next is the best choice, because no matter what, it will just terminate at the next surface that it runs into, so I can actually use multiple surfaces in this particular example. Next, we'll take a closer look at the differences between going a specific distance and through all. So this is eventually going to be a gasket. I'm going to extrude the shape 1/4 inch. And then I'm going to start a new sketch on the surface here. I'm going to project geometry of the entire outside shape. Then I'm going to use my offset tool to bring that in, we'll say 1/4 inch. And then I'll finish. So I want to cut this inside portion out. I choose my extrude tool. I select the inside portion here. As you can see, it's going the wrong way, so I'll flip it into the part. It automatically selected cut. If it didn't, I would go ahead and pick it here. And you can see that the depth is 1/4 inch, the same as that original extrusion. My choices at this point are to accept that or to instead choose through all. Let's talk about the difference between those. I'm going to leave it at 1/4 inch. So one of the things you've probably heard me talk about before is design intent. What is the intent of this hole? Is the intent to cut 1/4 inch into this part? Or is the intent to always cut completely through the part? Because let's say we had an engineering change and now the gasket is going to be 3/8 inch thick. I go and edit my original extrusion and change the value to 3/8 and enter. And as you can see, the cut only goes 1/4 inch into the part. So I have to go and I have to edit the second extrusion as well and change that value to 3/8. But if I instead choose through all, then it will always cut completely through the part. So even if I come back to the original extrusion and I change it to say 1 inches and click OK, then you can see that the inside portion continues to cut through the part. Next, we'll take a look at the ability to slice graphics to get inside of a part. I'm going to create a feature on the mid plane here in the middle of this part. So I'll sketch on it, and when I do this, my screen automatically turns to look directly at that plane. The problem is I've got this feature in the way. To take care of this, we can slice graphics. If I right click my mouse, I will find slice graphics here in my pop-up menu. I can also press the F7 function key to do this. And when I choose that, it's basically just going to slice everything between my eyes and the sketch plane. So basically just cut half of the part off here. Now I can go ahead and sketch whatever I need in here. Another tool that we have, similar to project geometry, is project cut edges. If I select this option, it will automatically project all of the cut edges at this plane. So there you can see that it projected all of those all at once without even having to click on them to select them. And then of course I can go ahead and start creating some sort of shape and constraining it. Next, on this particular shape, I am going to extrude it two directions here, and I want to add a taper angle each time. So I'm going to begin by extruding the circular shape here. I'm going to go ahead and flip it so that it's going back. And then I'm going to go to a selected surface. So I'll choose two, and I'll select this surface here. Next, I want to add a taper angle. So I can come down here to my taper angle, and I'll try a 15 degree. That's kind of big. I'll go back to a 10 degree angle here. I can also flip so that the 10 goes in instead, but I'll go ahead and have it flip to go out. So again, very easy to add a taper angle into a shape. I'll go ahead and click OK. And I basically want to do the same thing and extrude it the other direction. If I extrude though, I need a sketch to extrude. So what I can do is I can share an existing sketch. To do so, I find it in the browser, then I right-click on it and choose Share Sketch. Old versions of Inventor used to have a little hand for this symbol to indicate that it's shared. Now we get the little share symbol that you often see on mobile devices, the three little dots with the lines connecting them. This indicates it's a shared sketch. Not only does it show me the symbol here, but it also creates a copy of this sketch as a first level item as well. So now I can go ahead and extrude and select the same shape. Then once more, I can go ahead and choose the two option, add in a taper angle, and then click OK. So that way I was able to reuse the same sketch. The last thing to note about a shared sketch, though, is that the visibility stays on even after you extrude it. So typically if you sketch and then you extrude, that sketch is consumed and turned off so that you can't see it. But when you share a sketch, it stays on. So I just simply need to come over to the browser and on either section here of Sketch 2, right click on it and turn off the visibility check so that it's no longer showing on screen. That concludes this video on sketching secondary features. Again, really focusing on the extrude command right now.